The Cincinnati Reds' quest for pitching depth may actually take a big step back before it ever gets going here in the early offseason.
You are Locked On Reds, your daily Cincinnati Reds podcast, part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day.
Welcome into Locked On Reds. We are your daily source for all things Cincinnati Reds. I'm Stephen Offenbaker. He's Jeff Carr. We have a combined almost 14 years now of experience covering the Cincinnati Reds in podcast form. And that's because we love baseball. We love the Cincinnati Reds, and we have taken our love of the game, our love for this team, and we've turned it into information for you. Locked On Reds is part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every single day. And on today's podcast, we are going to be talking about getting the pitching or keeping the pitching. We're going to be talking about the pitching. We're going to be discussing if the Reds should try and keep Nick Martinez, what they could do to keep him around. We're going to be talking about the bullpen and if they should maybe go get a guy this offseason to help bolster the relief pitchers just a little bit. And we're going to be talking about the names that could be available on the free agent market for a fifth starter type guy, for an extra starting pitcher to bolster a rotation that God knows needed some help in 2024. You can never have too many pitching arms around. Before we get into any of that, shout out to today's sponsor of the podcast. That's FanDuel. You can get a big return on FanDuel. Place your first $5 bet and you'll get started with $200 in bonus bets back guaranteed. Just visit FanDuel.com to get started today. And where we're going to get started, Jeff, is with Mr. Nick Martinez, because he came in, the Reds signed him to a one-year deal with a one-year player option. And Nick Martinez pitched a season of his life. He just basically did everything the Reds asked him to do. You want me to be a reliever? I'll be a good reliever. You want me to be a starter? I'll be good starter, whatever you need, boss, was Nick Martinez's attitude. And I feel like he pitched so well for so long last season that it's almost a no-brainer to me that he's going to opt out of this deal.
Yeah, I think that he's earned himself a big payday, and not just money-wise, years-wise. He should be able to get himself a multi-year deal. We're talking 3, maybe even 4 years. Maybe he is set. Maybe this deal that he gets, because he's, you know, mid-30s, like myself, old, you know, we're getting fitted for an ice flow as we speak. But when it comes to Nick Martinez in baseball years, he is toward the end of his career. So this will be the last big contract, the last chance he has at a big contract. So there, I almost would put a 100% chance on him not picking up this player option. Now, there is no buyout for him, but I think that doesn't matter. He's going to go get himself a nice deal. And then you add on top of the Nick Martinez of it all, Jacob Junis has a mutual option. I don't know that he picks that up, because he's had a pretty solid year as well. He might go earn himself some more money. And you've got a couple of other guys, you know, Emilio Pagan's got a player option and things like that. This Reds pitching staff that has already been decimated by injury in the offseason, as much as that stinks to talk about, but Julian Aguiar, Brandon Williamson, not going to be pitching next year because of Tommy John. They're going to lose some more guys here. So that's going to be the big challenge for Nick Kroll outside of getting the outfield. Like we said on yesterday's episode, really broke down what Nick Kroll needs to do with the outfield. He's also got a lot of work to do with the pitching staff here.
Yeah, I think he has to make Nick Martinez an offer. The piece you left out there, Jeff, is that Nick Martinez is represented by Scott Boras. And he's going to be trying to get him the biggest, best deal. Because you're right, this is probably Martinez's last big deal, right? This is his last opportunity to go out there and make some money. So I think that's going to effectively move him out of the Reds' price range. Because remember, we're talking about a fifth starter is really what they need. And you're hoping that it's a guy who loses his job somewhere around June or July to a Chase Burns or a Chase Petty or Connor Phillips or somebody like that. So I don't know that the Reds are going to be willing to tie up $20 million a year in a starting pitcher for a 3 or 4 year deal when you really are hoping that one of the young guys comes and takes that job away anyhow.
And there's everybody's favorite offseason term, the qualifying offer. The qualifying offer is over $21 million. So if they, if he opts out, or, you know, if he doesn't pick up his player option, the Reds would have to pony up 20, I think it's $21.8 million for the qualifying offer. And he's going to want multiple years. So I think he's going to even turn that down because he can get that security for multiple years, not just this next year. And that for me is interesting because I feel like getting Nick Martinez is not like it was last offseason. Last offseason, the Reds gave him sort of a multi-use contract. Like, you're going to be a reliever, you're going to be a starter when we need you, things like that. He pitched so well as a starter to end this season that he absolutely deserves, he earned the right to get a starting pitcher's contract, not a, you know, prove it as a starter, but you're be a relief pitcher no matter what type deal. And the reason, the other reason too, we kind of buried this lead, the player option that he has for this next season, he actually gets paid less than he made last year. So he's not going to make less money for a better year that he had. It's just, he's turning that down. Moving from Nick Martinez to Jacob Junis, though, Jacob Junis is interesting. He didn't start as much as Nick Martinez did here to end the season, but when he did, he was effective. And when he pitched out of the bullpen for the Reds, except for that first appearance, I remember we were in attendance and he got his brains beat in. But other than that, he was effective. So I think that the mutual option that he holds, and both he and the team need to accept it, is for $8 million. He might could push $9, $10 million for a multi-year deal.
Maybe. I think if we're talking about these two pitchers, if we're talking about Martinez and Junis, it's much more likely that the Reds can keep Junis around, whether it's he declines the offer, but they turn right around to have another contract ready to go, something like that. But I could see them keeping him around. Whereas I'm pretty much resigned to the fact that Nick Martinez will be pitching someplace else in 2025. So
it'd be a big negative to lose both of them.
And are you looking at Junis to be that fifth starter? Is that your thought process there?
I almost think that I think he could fill the role that Nick Martinez filled this past year, where it's like you're more so counting on him out of the bullpen, but if you need him to start, he can. And with that, like, that at least gives you somewhat of a safety net. If you don't have somebody earn that fifth job out of camp, you can be like, well, Junis has got this. I don't necessarily know that if they keep Junis, that precludes them from going and signing another guy to compete for that fifth spot. I think I prefer that if it's Junis and you lose Martinez, but I don't think I would pencil him in as the fifth starter as soon as he's signed, I think is what I'm getting at.
Yeah, I think that's probably fair. And I heard you shout out our good friend Chad with Hope Is Not a Strategy on that show you did by yourself a couple days back. And I think that applies here, where the Reds hope that Chase Petty, Chase Burns, Connor Phillips, somebody comes and takes that fifth spot. They're going to have to prepare if those guys aren't going to be ready to go. So you got to go get another starting pitcher.
So before we get out of this, what is, and this isn't a fun question, but what are the odds that the Reds keep Junis and bet on Graham Ashcraft figuring it out as a starter? Mm-hmm.
60-40 in favor of that scenario. I think to start the season, because the ideal, I think ideally what Nick Craw would love to see happen is for Graham Ashcraft to be a serviceable fifth, and then one of those young guys to have a lights out, you know, April, May in the minor leagues and get a call up, take the fifth spot from Ashcraft, who then becomes your back end of the bullpen guy with Alexis Diaz. I think that's the direction it's going. They haven't come right out and said that, but there is a lot of peripheral discussion around the Reds and Graham Ashcraft in the bullpen. And that doesn't happen unless internal conversations have started to leak out to the media. And you know how closely guarded things are with the Reds clubhouse. But, you know, those conversations, I think, have reached a point where there is a plan. There is a plan for Graham Ashcraft to ultimately be in the bullpen.
Let's keep this up. You know what? I'm going to put on my thinking cap here. We're going to figure this out. How do the Reds fix this starting pitching depth thing? Because there are options out there. Talk about what those are coming up next. You can get a big return this NFL season over on FanDuel, America's number one sportsbook. When you get a hunch in the middle of the game, you can check out the latest stats, view live play-by-play, and so much more, all on the same place where you place your bets over at FanDuel. And plus, you'll get started with $200 in bonus bets guaranteed when you place your first $5 bet, i.e., you don't even have to win. You place a $5 bet, you get $200 in bonus bets. The World Series is set, and look, regardless of how much we all hate the Dodgers and the Yankees, I think we can all agree that we're, seeing Shohei Ohtani and Aaron Judge in the World Series is objectively cool. With that, FanDuel has interesting odds set on the World Series going to seven games. Right now, it's at plus 190. So wagering $10 would get you $19 if the World Series did, in fact, go to seven games. And look, I want more baseball. So yes, I want that to happen. Let's go over 6.5 games. That's over on FanDuel.com. We're talking Cincinnati Reds all day, every day, every week, every month, all year long. Make sure you subscribe to Lockdown Reds to get at least 30 minutes of Reds talk in your feed every single day. All right, Steve, we looked at some of the guys who could be leaving, who should be staying, all that other stuff. By the way, quick note on that. I had mentioned Emilio Pagan. I think he picks up his player option after having dealt with injuries and ineffectiveness last year. And then I do think the Reds pick up the club option on Brent Suter.
Oh, yeah, that's a no-brainer. Absolutely.
Yeah, I don't think he's going anywhere. So that should help out the bullpen and continue to keep it as a strength. We'll get into some options that the Reds could have in the bullpen here in a few minutes, but let's look at some starting options because the Reds coming into this offseason, it's clear they need outfield help and they need pitching depth. Just about every team needs pitching depth, but there are a lot of options in both areas. The starting pitchers that are out there that are very intriguing, not guys that are in the, Corbin Burns role, as much as that would be awesome if the Reds went out and got Corbin Burns. But I think we both agree you don't need to go out and spend for a big time starter. And there's plenty of options for guys like that.
No, it's a placeholder, really. I mean, if everything goes according to plan, and, I understand there's a lot of ifs and a lot of moving parts in this thing. But one of Chase Petty, Chase Burns, Connor Phillips should be ready to go sometime in 2025. So the guy that you're signing is an insurance policy, is a placeholder, is to help alleviate some wear and tear on arms. Nick Lodolo has yet to put together a full healthy season. Hunter Greene has yet to put together a full healthy season. Andrew Abbott has yet to put together a full healthy season. So having six starters really is kind of a no-brainer, I think, heading into 2025. So this guy is going to be somebody that is kind of in that Nick Martinez lane, a guy that can spot start here, maybe go to the bullpen until he needs to be back into the rotation to go back to the bullpen. So I don't think you're talking about a huge high-dollar move here. I think you're talking about somebody that can just be reliable.
Yeah, and I differ a little bit, like not crazy much, but I kind of wouldn't mind if it were a legit starting pitcher guy that, as long as he's healthy, he's in the rotation all year, because I think the opportunities based on Lodolo, based on Abbott, based on Greene will present themselves in some way. And look, Rhett Lauder, we're penciling him into the starting rotation because he deserves that, but he's never pitched a full workload either, so he might be on a little bit of a pitch count. Could see him, hit the IL for reasons that are basically load management. So you need that other guy. And I think for me, that kind of puts me in the category of there's guys like Jose Quintana who's going to be out there. He's been around, especially been around the NL Central, has seen some things and understands these opponents. He would be valuable. A guy like Walker Buehler on a bit of a resurgent, like, can he figure it back out contract? Can he stay healthy? Again, that's another kind of built-in risk where it's like they're signing Walker Buehler, don't have to give up a ton of money to do it. And on the other end of the spectrum, if he does have health issues, you've got some guys that could step in there and then he gets Wally Pipped. I mean, maybe you're setting a guy up to be Wally Pipped, but I almost wouldn't mind it if that's not the goal and they do get somebody who can stick in there for 162.
So you'd be okay if that was a reclamation project in that fifth starter spot? I would not be. I wouldn't mind Quintana. I don't have any problem with that. But Buehler is a reclamation project.
Yeah.
I don't think that that's where this team is. That's the same old stuff, right? That's the same old thing the Reds do. And I don't want them to do that. If you're going to go get a starter, go get a starter. If you're going to go get a guy that you want to be your fifth dude, go get that dude. But don't get somebody and hope that DJ can fix them, because I'm tired of that.
No, that's a good point. I think I might be with you on that regard. I know that Walker Buehler has just been really, really high level in the past, but yeah, if we could avoid the guys who just get their arm attached, like Frankie Montas or something like that, if we could avoid that, that'd be all right. You know, Kyle Gibson's going to be out there. We could see, you know, the possibility of maybe Yusei Kikuchi would be an interesting look. I mean, a lefty pitched for Houston this past year, pitched pretty well for Toronto in his past. So I wouldn't mind to see some options like that. I think that there are definitely some guys, too, that you don't have to go crazy with, and you could probably see in the less than Nick Martinez range. That's kind of where I think the Reds will cut it off as far as looking for guys. They got to be a little bit less than that, because I even wonder how other teams view Nick Martinez in their own kind of evaluations. He could be a mid-rotation guy.
So it's a good year for Nick Martinez to opt out of that contract, given the success that he had, and then looking at what the top end of this free agent pitcher market looks like it could be, depending on a couple of the names. If Verlander decides to continue on, if Scherzer decides to continue on, Blake Snell is going to be a free agent again. These are all pitchers that are going to want big dollar deals. So the top end is going to be pretty pricey. And then for guys like Nick Martinez, they're going to naturally get a bump as that market adjusts up. So where the Reds, where that lane is, you know, pitching is always prohibitively expensive. Yes. We talk about this. This is why the Reds are trying to develop their own from within on pitching and drafting pitching as much as they can, and then hopefully going out and getting that hitter to fill a need. I don't know, Jeff. I don't know what they're going to be able to get in a price range that seems reasonable, given the other things we want them to do, because that outfield move has to happen first. So I don't know. I don't know what this market's going to, what's going to spare out.
And I think that takes us back to our initial point, is that as much as getting the team better and getting the team ready for the playoffs in 2025 is the goal, you also need to consider that Chase Petty, Chase Burns, and Connor Phillips are probably a part of that plan in some way, shape, or form. I think what would you target? Like, I think almost 15, and you could probably, depending on how they start the season, you might even see all three of them at some different points. Could you see like 15 starts being the max for any one of those three guys?
Of those rookies? Yeah. I think they've all got to go pitch a couple months in the minor leagues anyway. I don't think that anybody is going to be ready to go right out of Goodyear. So they're all going to go pitch down a little bit. I think 15 is reasonable. And you hit the nail on the head where 15 from multiple of them. That's not 15 from one of them. I could see them combining to equal a big league starting pitcher through the year. You know, that's, you're talking there 30 to 32 starts, right? I could see two of those guys being able to get in enough starts to equal a starting pitcher throughout the course of 2025.
So let's say the goal then, and we've been talking about, oh, the Reds need to sign starting pitching help. They need a bona fide starter, or at least a reliable starter, something like that. What we categorically, like what we really are getting at, is that the combination of Phillips, Petty, and Burns should be counted on to be no more than the sixth best starter on this depth chart. They should have five starters ahead of those guys that they can count on.
Until,
right now they have four. I don't know.
Until such time, right. Until such time as one of those guys just establishes themselves as dominant and takes it away, then yes, I think that's probably a pretty succinct way to put it.
Yeah. So with that, though, the Reds need bullpen help because everybody needs bullpen help. But there are a lot of bullpen arms out there, and we're going to tell you who our favorites are coming up next. Are you already out of it in your fantasy football league? Get back into it with Prize Picks, America's number one daily fantasy sports app. And it's so easy to see why they are the number one daily fantasy sports app, because you can win up to 100 times your money with as little as 4 correct picks in an entry. All you have to do is you pick your 4 favorite players and your favorite statistics. You get a hunch. You think Joe Burrow is going to hit more on the passing yards. Think Jamar Chase is going to hit more on the touchdowns. Pick them. Put them all together in an entry and see your money multiply. Like I said, you could turn $10 even into $1,000 pretty easily. Download the Prize Picks app today and use the code LOCKEDONMLB and get $50 instantly when you play $5. You don't even have to win. That's code LOCKEDONMLB to get $50 instantly when you play $5. That's over at Prize Picks. Run your game.
If you haven't done so yet, make sure you have clicked that like button, that subscribe button, that notification bell. You've helped grandma and grandpa get on YouTube, and you've made sure all your friends know about Locked On Reds, because we love talking baseball with you. We want to talk baseball with them because we love talking baseball. All right, Jeff, let's talk about this bullpen for a minute, because bullpen always can stand to have an upgrade, but I think we're only going to be talking about one spot being open in this bullpen. You know, we've gone through this a couple times as the season was winding down, but looking at the list, I don't know that there's going to be a lot of turnover out there in the bullpen.
Yeah, because you've got 8 spots, because you cannot have more than 13 pitchers. You got 5 starters. So you definitely have Alexis Diaz, definitely have Sam Maul, definitely have Brent Suter, because we think that the option gets picked up. Really hope that Jacob Junis is a part of that. So you already got 4 right there. Then you're probably talking about Tony Santion returning, probably talking about Fernando Cruz returning. So that's 6. Mm-mm. You don't think Fernando Cruz comes back?
No, he's going to Louisville, or he's going to be looking for a job someplace else. I think they've gotten all of out of Fernando Cruz that they're going to get. But I mean, let's go through that again. You're right. Alexis Diaz will be a guy.
Yeah.
Ian Jabeau, Sam Maul, Brent Suter, Jacob Junis, Emilio Pagan, Tony Santion. There's your 7. You've got room for one more.
Yeah, and that makes me wonder a bit how high they go with that, because I think you and I both agree they need somebody that can kind of push Alexis Diaz a little bit, not necessarily to be pushing for saves, but pushing for the best relief pitcher in this bullpen. The examples that we have been looking at are the teams in the playoffs right now. And then the Guardians just got eliminated, but outside of Emmanuel Class A, they also had Cade Smith and they had Hunter Gaddis, 2 guys that they could lean on for multiple innings if needed. The Yankees have Clay Holmes, who helps out Luke Weaver. And we're going to see him in the World Series. Luke Weaver's going to be in the World Series. What do I do here? I mean, Jeff Weaver was in the World Series a couple of years ago Jeff Hoffman was in. I'm getting Luke Weaver and Jeff Hoffman put together make one super crazy, ridiculous former Red. But yeah, like, I think that they need that guy that can supplement and maybe even push Alexis Diaz.
And here's another factor to consider, Jeff. If Graham Ashcraft doesn't make this rotation, he's going in this bullpen and it's full. So of those names we listed, is there somebody that you want to get rid of in order to go out and get a bullpen arm? Because that's what you're going to have to do.
Could they make it so that Ian Jabeau has to work for his job?
You risk losing him. I mean, you could bring in somebody on a prove it, you know, minor league invite kind of thing and hope they beat him out in the camp. But Jabeau doesn't have options, so you would expose him to going someplace else.
But maybe that's the goal. Maybe
that's your guy. You're saying you're willing. You're willing to part ways with Ian Jabeau.
I think scenario. If you can improve on him, yes.
Okay. I agree. I mean, I think if you got somebody's better than who you got, you know, then sorry about your luck. You know, we played the options game looking through this bullpen right as the season was ending, Jeff. And I mean, Alexis Diaz is not getting sent down. Tony Santion still has options, but I mean, he was pitching really good there in stretches in 2024. I don't know that he's the guy that you want to send down. So, you know, it's that type of scenario where you either cut a guy or you kind of roll with what you got.
In a perfect world, though, in a perfect world, you have Tony Santion as your first guy up from Louisville in the bullpen, and then you have Fernando Cruz as your second guy up from Louisville in the bullpen. That could be interesting. Maybe you go get a Blake Treinen, former closer for the Dodgers, or maybe you go get, I don't know, like a Kendall Graveman, former Astros closer. Maybe you do go get a Paul Sewald, guys who have that experience in the late innings, in the big stages during the postseason, bring them into the bullpen, and then you've got competition for Tony Santion and for Fernando Cruz.
And so you'd be willing to send Tony Santion down then?
Yes.
To start the season. Okay.
Yeah, if it's an options game, I think I would.
I agree. If you want to have depth and you want to push this team to be better, then nobody's job is guaranteed, right? And that's how you do it. You go bring in other players to challenge. I think of all the team needs, though, Jeff, this would be a luxury signing, I think, because we've identified they have to get the outfielder. We've now talked about they really do need to address one more starting pitcher that's ready to go on opening day. They don't have that in the minor leagues right now. So they have to do that. If they're going to do a bullpen arm too, I think we're getting greedy. I think we might be expecting too much out of them because we want two outfielders and a starting pitcher. And then, yeah, why not we go ahead and upgrade the bullpen too? Why not?
Yeah, I think you're right. I think that we may have talked ourselves out. Coming into this segment, I was ready to talk about why they need an elite bullpen guy, but I think we've talked ourselves out.
Well, no, you're not wrong. They do need an elite bullpen guy. They need the two-punch of the 1-2 punch to go in the back end of that bullpen. But the question is, will they have the resources to do it? And let's assume that they do. Then which guy are you getting rid of to make it happen? I like the idea of stashing some depth in Louisville because we've seen that they're eventually going to get called up. They're going to get to play at the big league level. And I don't want that depth to be Fernando Cruz. I'm nowhere near as high on him, I think, as you still are. I've seen enough. I'm ready to move on from it. I think that, you know, he was a late bloomer. They got a bit out of him. You know, he's heading into his age 35 season, Jeff. I think it's time to just move on from Fernando Cruz.
And that's, I don't know that I can argue that fervently. I mean, I love the swing and miss potential that he's got, but man, he walks a lot of people. So that's kind of tough. And we saw that walks killed the Mets in their series with the Dodgers. I mean, that was probably the biggest factor in the Mets losing the NLCS. So I definitely want to mitigate that problem as much as possible. But my whole thought with this too is not necessarily that the Reds need an entire new bullpen just for new bullpen's sake. It's that I've seen the success that the Dodgers have with all of the turnover that they have had in their bullpen. I mean, Kenley Jansen was their closer a couple of years ago. He hasn't been on the team in a while, and they've kept on rolling like they've had an elite bullpen every single year. So part of that's probably the pitching coach and that, but.
Well, and unless you have a guy named Mariano Rivera down there to close out ball games, relief pitching, you know, it ebbs and it flows. What do you always say? They're a fickle thing.
It's a fickle thing.
They're, you know, you never know what you're getting in a relief pitcher from year to year. And I'll have no problem churning the bullpen if you're always moving in an upward direction. I don't want them to churn the bullpen in a cost-saving move. But if they can go out and get somebody that's better, then go get somebody that's better. And whoever loses their job. They'll catch on someplace else. I want the Reds to have the good bullpen. So
I have nothing to add from the bullpen box of chocolates. That's how we've got in today's podcast. Thanks everybody for checking out today's Lockdown Reds so much. Appreciate you always making us your first listen. Check out Lockdown MLB for your second listen. Have a link to that down in the description of today's episode so you don't have to go searching for it. Make sure you click on that and check out Sully's coverage every single day on the MLB playoffs. We are all part of the Lockdown Podcast Network, your team every single day. Steve, take us away.
All right, that's going to do it, folks. Make sure you click subscribe, click that like button, click that notification bell. We're going to keep our ears to the ground, listening for the rumors, checking out the news, trying to figure out what this team's going to do next to get the Francoa era started. And we're going to keep you locked on Reds every single day.
Bullpen's like a box of chocolates. You never know what you're going to get.
Oh, Alabama, Huntsville West.